8, the Apostle Paul says, "Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." Notice how he says, "For the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord." There's an excellency, the educators say sunum bonum, supreme good. There's something very special about knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. And what I've, the last few weeks, tried to do and just look at something that, for me, is a very fascinating thing about the Lord Jesus Christ. He's God the Son. He's the second member of the Godhead. And in the Bible, you often see the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father communicate, talking back and forth. And when you do, it's fascinating to me. Very often in his earthly ministry, you'd see him pray. He'd get up in the morning and go out and pray. He'd pray all night before events and so forth. So you know he's communing with the Father. But there are only a couple of times where you actually see him audibly address the Father. And when you do, you're seeing him commune with the Father. But there are other places. We looked at Psalm 2, we looked at Psalm 45, Psalm 102, and Psalm 110, where Christ speaks, the Father speaks back, and they commune back. And it's, what do they say to one another? What do they talk about? How do they do it? Those kind of things are always fascinating to me, because when you talk about prayer, prayer is one of the subjects that people just get really into and into confusion with. And it's always, in my mind, when you know the Lord Jesus Christ, you have an excellency of what God's doing and who he is and the preciousness of that. I want you to look at John 17. We've looked at the Psalms and so forth, and my intention originally was just to look at those Psalms, but then my wife told me that I had taught 5 lessons and I needed to teach 3 more because she has to send them out to the Tape of the Month people in packets of 4. So since my wife told me that, I figured, well, that's as close to God talking to me directly as it's going to happen. So I must obey. And as I was thinking about it, I had a whole list of passages that I'd been thinking about. I just picked those Psalms because they were in the Psalms, and it was pretty clear to see it back and forth. But I thought, well, I'd like to look with you at John chapter 17. Verse number 1, "These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour is come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I've glorified thee on the earth. I've finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was." The Lord Jesus Christ, he's spent chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16 with his apostles in the upper room. And these words spake Jesus. You have all that information. And now he is there in the upper room with them and lifts up his eyes and he begins to pray. And you literally hear him communing with his Father. Come back with me to Isaiah chapter 50. This is something that he does all through his life. In fact, it's a very important part of his earthly life. Isaiah chapter 50. In a passage that's describing the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Verse 4, "The Lord God," and I've told you many times that when you see Lord and God, the word God in uppercase, that's God the Father, that's Adonai Jehovah, and that is the way God the Father is identified. "The Lord, God the Father, hath given me," and that'll be Jesus, "the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary." Watch. "He waketh morning by morning. He waketh mine ear to hear as the learned. Every day, God the Father and God the Son spent time together with each other. Now, it says in the morning, and I've told you many times, I'm not a morning person. I was up last night till 2:30. That's sort of in the morning. Then I went to bed. I don't want to get up. You don't call me at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. I'll have just gone to sleep. But other people, most people aren't quite that time challenged. And folks love to get up early in the morning. The whole day's ahead. In the morning, every day, God the Father, God the Son communed with one another. It was a constant kind of a thing. And you notice how he talks about, he hath given me the tongue of the learned. Waketh morning by morning, he waketh mine ear to hear as the learned. They studied together. And God the Father communicated and educated the Lord Jesus Christ in his humanity. The Lord Jesus Christ was in full, he was fully in tune with the Father's will. If you come over to John chapter 8, you know the passage in Hebrews chapter 10 where he quotes the Psalms and he says, A body hast thou prepared for me. I come to do thy will, O God. Jesus Christ in his humanity came for the purpose of doing the will, the plan that he and the Father had agreed to before the foundation, before the world began. John chapter 8, verse number 26. I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him. Daily they studied together. They understood not what he spake, that he spake to them of the Father. Then said he unto them, when ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall you know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me, I speak these things. And I say that, I just want to see, the Father was communicating to him, and they're communing with one another over what the will of the Father is. So when you come to John 17, he's going to pray. Now this time he's praying audibly. Very seldom did he ever pray out loud. Or if he did, only a few times are they actually recorded in your Bible. He's doing this, he's in the presence of the 12, they've had the supper, they've had all the conversation in chapter 15 and 16. And now before they go out to the Garden of Gethsemane, in their presence, he lifts up his eyes to heaven and he prays out loud so that the 12 apostles can hear him. Fortunately, God put it in his word so we can hear him. And it's very important. You get to see into the thinking, into the heart. You get to see into the personality of the Lord Jesus Christ in the presence of his Father. And he's going to do it just before the cross. He says in the verse, the hour has come. That's the cross. And he's looking at the next event is going to be go to Gethsemane. In fact, if you look at chapter 18, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Cedron, where was a garden, into which he entered and his disciples. And Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place. When he went into that, that's when he's in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's when he prays the three prayers, if this cup can pass. That's when Peter, James, and John go with him out and could have listened to him do that, but they fell asleep. John doesn't record any of that. John just passes, he doesn't record the Gethsemane scene at all. He doesn't record the Gethsemane prayers. But what John does in his epistle, in his book, is he demonstrates that Gethsemane was the experience of Christ's soul all the way to Calvary. J. Gamble Morgan made that statement, and it's true. All through this period of time, Christ knows the cross is where I'm going. He doesn't just have the agony in the garden. It starts way before. Come back with me to chapter 12. I want to go to John 17 by way of John 12, and you'll see it as we do this. You'll see what's going on here. But just listen to how Christ thinks and how he approaches the cross and how the Father responds. Now, the book of John, the first 12 chapters, people say, first thing, tell people, lost people to read the book of John. And that's because it talks about believing. But the first 12 chapters of the book of John are written for the public, for the nation. He came into his own received him not. The first thing he does, he preaches to the nation and the message to the. But beginning in chapter 13, he takes, that's just the night before the cross. And he take and he's, now he's, chapter 13 through 17 is just to his own. So most of the book is not written to lost people. Chapter 13, John presents him as the advocate to keep and to cleanse him, keep him fit. Chapter 14, he's the coming one. I'm coming. Chapter 15, he's the vine. Chapter 16, he's the giver of the Holy Spirit. Chapter 17, now he's going to be the high priest interceding with the Father. J. Siddle Baxter, I've said to him in the past that the first time as a teenager I studied through the Bible. I mean, actually studied it with some instruction. I used a book that fortunately had been placed into my hands. My parents gave it to me, called Explore the Book. It was written by J. Siddle Baxter. And what that book did for me, and would do for you if you use it, since I had was in six volumes, it's now one big volume. Baxter's been dead for many years. But it taught me how to read a book and get the flow of thought in the book, the way the book kind of flows and thinks and so forth. We're going to start studying the book of Ezekiel in a few weeks. And I was just now looking at Ezekiel chapter 1, reading the introduction that Scofield has, and he's got the book outlined based on certain statements, and what he says is very true. But when you read Ezekiel, that's not the way the book flows, and that's an important getting the kind of the concept and the flow of things is really important in understanding a book, and the book of John's that way. I had the opportunity to meet Baxter when I was in Bible school in Pensacola, Florida, and he came twice while I lived there and preached conferences in a church there. And I went and had the opportunity to hear him, and I expressed my gratitude for his book. And he said, well, we're going to go out to eat supper, get some, you know, go to Over Rice to get some ice cream. They went and got supper. And he said, would you like to go? Well, you know, I'm 19 years old. Sure, I would like to go. And so twice I had opportunity to go out and eat supper with him. And, you know, I didn't get to know him, but I had the opportunity to meet him. And he preached in one of those meetings on the book of John. And I thought it was kind of odd. He wouldn't let him record it because he said, I haven't written this, and I'm going to write this in a book one day, and I don't want somebody recording and preaching my material and them thinking I stole it from them. But he said, the book of John is in three parts. First, there's the outer court. That would be chapter 1 to 12. Then there's the inner court. That's where that would be chapter 13 through 16. That's where you're in the inner court. That's where the priest, you know, the showbread and that kind of thing. The priest operates. And then you have the most holy. And he said, that's John 17. What you've done in John 17 is you've moved in to a very special place where you just have the communion between the Father and the Son. And that's a wonderful thing. The things that take place in chapter 17 hook on to chapter 12. So go back to chapter 12, verse 20. John 12, verse 20. And there were certain Greeks, these are Gentiles, among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida, of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip came and telleth Andrew, that's his brother, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. Now, what's going on here is the festival, the Passover's going on. These Gentiles, they're obviously proselytes, they've come to worship. They've left their paganism, they've left the disillusion and disappointment of pagan religion. And they've come and joined the Jews' religion, But obviously, they've only found the same disillusion and disappointment in the Jews' religion, the same emptiness that they had in their paganism. They've heard about Christ. They come. They want to see him. They're looking for life, and they come to Christ. They come to Philip. They get Philip. Philip and Andrew are Gentile names, and they live in a Gentile city. So, you know, maybe that's why they did that. But they say, sirs, they were very respectful. We would see Jesus. Now, that's a great request. If you've ever preached at the Pacific Garden Mission years ago, I don't know what the new pulpit down there is, but the old pulpit had a little sign on it, sirs, we would see Jesus. Don't talk about everything else. That's who, you know, we need Jesus. And that's where it comes from. Philip and Andrew, and it's interesting, Philip, they talk to Philip. Then Philip goes, and instead of going to Jesus, he goes to Andrew. And you wonder, why would he hesitate? Why would he just go directly to Jesus? But you've got to remember, these men had been told, don't preach to the Gentiles. They'd been told, Christ had said to them, I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Wouldn't talk to the Gentile lady. So they had a little discussion among themselves. And so finally they do, let's let Christ decide. They tell Jesus. Now, the answer that Christ gives is fascinating, because when you see that on the pulpit of places and signs, let's preach Jesus, nobody ever gives this answer, because in the context, he never responds to them. In fact, in the context, he hides himself. So if you're going, we would see Jesus and you hide him, that's not the intent of putting it on your pulpit. But in the context, here's how he answers it, and you'll see why it is. Verse 23, Jesus answered them, saying, here's his answer to the Gentile proselytes wanting to see Jesus. The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. What? What in the world is that? Well, the hour is come. That's the hour to which his life's been moving from the very beginning. The whole issue in his coming is the cross. Now, the hour has come. And let's go back to chapter 17 and look at a verse now so that you can understand. Up until this time, he said the hour isn't come. You remember how, if you go back to John chapter 2, you remember the first time he says that is to his mother. He's not being disrespectful to her. He's being instructive. Chapter 2, that the marriage of the Canaan and the wedding at Canaan of Galilee. Verse number 3, when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said unto him, they have no wine. Jesus said unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. Now you can trace that phrase through the book of John. Over and over he will say, mine hour is not come. Mine hour is not come. Until you come to chapter 12 and it says, now the hour is here. So something is changing. Chapter 17, verse number 4, and we'll talk about this when we get there, but I just want you to see it. Jesus, as he begins to pray, and the first 5 verses he prays for himself, he says in verse 4 to the Father, I have glorified thee on the earth. Watch, I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. So there is a work that he has finished. But he hadn't gone to the cross yet. There was a work he was doing when my hour hadn't come. But now that work is finished, and now the real reason behind me being here, the cross, is the issue. So the work that he finished isn't the issue anymore. Now the cross is the issue. So there's a change taking place here. Now what was the work? Well, Luke chapter 12, verse 32, it says, fear not, little flock, it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. He came, John says he came into his own received him not, but to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. He came to call out a believing remnant out of the nation Israel. He came to produce a little flock of believers in Israel to whom he would give the kingdom. That gathering them together has been accomplished. The issue of getting together that greater, that remnant of people is there. So now the greater work yet remains. If you look back at chapter 16, verse 32, he's talking to his apostles. Behold, the hour cometh. Yea, now is. So now it's here. That ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. Yet I'm not alone, because my Father is with me. So he's aware of what's going on. And you notice he says, if you go back to chapter 12, verse 23, the hour is come. By the way, what you're reading here in John 12, the reason I went back here, this is the last incident in the earthly ministry that John records. In other words, when you get here, you're looking at the last things that John is going to tell you about Christ's earthly ministry. Chapter 13, he's with the disciples in the upper room, skips all the way over to the upper room. So the way John leaves his ministry is Christ saying this. Some Gentiles come, want to see him. Wait a minute, before I see them, there's something else got to be done. Because the hour's come. Gathering the little flock's done, now I'm headed to the cross. That the Son of Man should be glorified. When he says that, how does he look at the hour? How is it that he, in his mind, is thinking about the cross? He's not saying, oh, this terrible, awful, wicked thing is happening. He's saying, I'm going to go to the cross and the Son of Man's going to be glorified. That's his vision. That's his estimate of Calvary. Come over with me to Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 9. Here's a verse that for many years I didn't read very carefully. And when I finally did, it stunned me. Here's one of the excellencies. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ counted above everything doing the Father's will. The cross was his will. He knew that. And for him, above everything, the passion of his heart was to do the Father's will. And when he looked at the cross, he didn't look at the sufferings. In fact, Hebrews 12 says he despised. It was not worthy of consideration because he was doing the Father's will. An interesting verse about the, now is the Son of Man glorified. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. He became a man. But what do we see? We see him crowned with glory and honor. Now you see that next word? It doesn't say he was crowned with glory and honor because he, by the grace of God, tasted death for every man. That's where I read that verse in my head for many years. Then it dawned on me one day, that isn't what that verse said. Pay attention. He's crowned with glory and honor that the purpose and the intent of crowning him with glory and honor is that he might, by the grace of God, taste death for every man. The glory and honor was the right, the privilege to die, taste death for every man, to do the Father's will. When he looked at the cross, it was this is the Father, this is what we planned. This is the Father's will. I've been educated. I understand. I'm walking in what the Father has taught me. I know exactly what his will is, and I'm perfectly in tune with it. Now go back to John 12 and see why he says that. Here's another strange verse. This verse gets used by all kind of different ways. John 12:12. Starting verse John 12, 23. Jesus answered them, saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat, a grain of wheat, fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. Now, you know that's true. But what he's saying is, before we can have the harvest, in the harvest, the Gentiles come in. In the harvest, the world is brought to the Messiah through Israel. But before we can have the harvest, before the Gentiles can, we would see Jesus, it only comes through the cross. I got to go there first. There's no other way to have the harvest except through the cross. Now that's the idea there. He that loveth his life shall lose it. He that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there he shall also my servants be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now he's just saying, you do it my way, not any other way. But you see where he says, verse 20, if any man, that's the harvest. But you can't get to the harvest until you've gone to the cross. Verse 27, now here's the contrast. Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. Isn't that what you would say? I talked to some people just this past week. I've talked to three people. One's having open heart surgery. One's has a spouse that's died and has left them in difficult straits. And another's having some real physical difficulties in their family. And their soul is troubled. And they would all say, Father, let this pass. Save me from this hour. He said, is that what I'm going to say? Because of the trouble in my soul about what's fixing to happen? But for this hour came I, but for this cause came I unto this hour. This is why I'm here. This is why I was incarnate, became man. I've lived, done these things. This is the purpose that the Father has. I'm going to. He kept one thing in his mind. Father, verse 28, glorify thy name. That's what he's looking for. The only passion of his heart was to have the Father glorified, honored. In spite of the trouble of his own soul, you see, my soul is, that's Gethsemane. That's what he's doing in Gethsemane. That's when he's struggling with, shall I say, Father, take this away from me? And he comes to the point where he says, if it's thy will, take it away. But he never says, take it away. We'll see when we get in the book of chapter 7 and praying. He prays the Father's will, but then the Father's will is what he prays. Here he says in Gethsemane, my flesh is weak, spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak. So there's that struggle in his humanity. But what's he doing? He's choosing to do the Father's will. There's an excellency. If we have enough time, I'm going to talk to you about the faith of Christ. That's what you're seeing in operation here. And the way the faith of Christ, his faith in the Father's will, his trust and dependence in the Father's word and will, that's what his prayer focuses on. That's how he could do it. Now you see, when he says Father, now he's going to address the Father. That's a prayer. That's sort of like what we used to call a Nehemiah prayer. You know what a Nehemiah prayer is? No. Nehemiah chapter 2, Nehemiah is the cupbearer before the king. And the king, he's heard all about the terrible situation in Jerusalem with the captivity and all, and how things are going. And he comes in to the king, and the king looks at him and says, boy, you look kind of down today, Nehemiah. What's the matter? What do you need? And he said, I prayed to God, made my request, and then I told the king. And Nehemiah prayers when you don't have an opportunity to sit and, you know, labor for hours in prayer begging God for something. You just got to get it on. That's what Jesus does here. Is he soul's troubled? What do I say? Save me? But for this, your will, I'm here. Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Heaven couldn't remain silent when Christ prays that. By the way, three times at his baptism, at his at the Mount of Transfiguration, and here, the heavens open and the Father speaks. It's interesting to hear the Father, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Every time he affirms him, he identifies him, this is my beloved Son. In Luke, that's Matthew. In Luke, he says that, thou art my beloved Son. One, Matthew affirms it to the crowd. But Luke, taking that personal approach, he says, "Thou art," a confirmation in the communion between Christ and the Father. And that's not diminishing anything. What that is what he says in chapter 17. He says, "Glorify thy Son." Then verse 5, he says, "Glorify me." There's that communion between them, the oneness. And the Father affirms that at the beginning of his ministry. Here, he says, "I have both glorified it and shall." If you come to Acts chapter 2, you'll see the testimony of that. Hath, past tense, shall, future tense. Acts chapter 2, verse 22. "Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, as you yourselves also know." God did these miracles, signs, wonders by Christ. Christ had laid aside the independent exercise of his powers to become man. But he's not forsaken. Everything he did in his life, in his ministry, was because the Father gave him those instructions. And he's doing the will of God. He's God. He could say, "My sins be forgiven." Only God can do that. But he didn't do it independently. He did it in connection with the will of God. He's approved of God by miracles, signs that God did by him. Everything he did was in obedience to the Father. So he has been glorified. The Father has honored him. And he shall. Verse number 32, Acts 2:32. This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we all are witnesses. He goes to the cross, he dies, the Father raises him up, according to the glory of the Father. Wherefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he hath shed forth this which you now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he himself saith, "Lord, the Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand until I make thy foes thy footstool. Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made this same Jesus, whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ." He said, "I have glorified him, and I will." That's the resurrection, his exaltation at the Father's right hand, and his coming, his return in power and great glory. So all of that is the prospect there. And heaven opens and shouts that out. Now John 12, verse 29. "The people, therefore, that stood by and heard it, said it thundered. Others said, an angel spake to him." They heard the noise. They didn't hear the voice. Only Christ heard that. That's like Paul on the road to Damascus. Christ speaks to him. People around, they don't hear the voice. They don't understand what's being said. They just hear the noise. They see the light. It's interesting, the reaction. Some said, it thundered. Others said, you know, there's something a little more than that. There's something supernatural. An angel had talked to him. This guy's different. Verse number 30, Jesus answered and said, "This voice came not because of me, but for your sakes." In other words, it got their attention and it affirmed who he was. Now is the judgment. Now, and here's what's happening now that the hour. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. This he said, signifying what death he should die. Now is the judgment. There's a process going on here. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince. The process for reclaiming the earth back under the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, the actual process is beginning. You remember the law and the prophets were until John? Since then the kingdom of God is preached and all men press into it. There's a dispensational progression going on here. Now he's got the little flock ready. Now I'm going to go to the cross and I'm going to defeat the prince of this world. And I'm going to take back the authority that he usurped. And I'm going to begin the reclamation process. We'll see that again in 17. So the death His resurrection, his ascension, his exaltation, his coming back in glory, that's all involved there. If you drop down to verse 46, I am come a light into the world. Now, again, this is the way John ends his record of Christ's public ministry. He's looking to the future. Verse 46, I'm come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me shall not abide in darkness. We gave the kids teenagers Bible Sunday. I always write in the front of it, one of the verses I write is, the entrance of thy word giveth light. It giveth understanding to the simple. Christ comes as light. Without him, the light goes out. There's darkness. And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which has sent me. He commanded, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said to me, so I speak. This is all the Father's doing. This is what the Father's saying. I'm just doing the Father's business. You remember that's what he said when he was 12 in the temple? I must be about my Father's business. He's completely aware of what the business is. He's doing the Father's will, and he delights in doing it. That's where his glory is. Now, that's why you come to chapter 17, and he starts out the way he does. Because the last thing that the record has him saying to the Father is the things in chapter 12. Now, when you come to chapter 17, if you just, before you get there, look at chapter 13, verse 1. Because after he says 12:50, now, before the feast of the Passover, there's some time passed, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And the supper being in, and they've had the supper, now he's going to talk to his own. And chapter 13, chapter 14, chapter 15, chapter 16, he's just talking to the 12. And of course, Judas leaves. Chapter 16, verse number 32. Behold, the hour cometh. Now, this is the end of the conversation. Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I'm not alone, because the Father's with me. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world you should have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes. So he spake all those words, and then he turns his attention from them and lifts up his eyes to the Father. And now he's going to pray. And again, he's praying with them, in the midst of them, so they hear him. And he's going to pray to the Father. Father, the hour is come. We're there. In the presence of the Father talking to him before the cross, he knows exactly what's going on. Now, he's going to pray. We looked at verse 4. When he said, I've glorified thee in the earth, I've finished the work which thou gavest me to do. The work specifically was to gather the little flock. But more specifically, it was to gather the 12 apostles. If you see the thing which the Father has given me, if you look at verse number 6, I have manifest thy name unto the men which thou gavest me. Now, this is one of the verses that Calvinists used to say God before the foundation of the world, you know, selected a certain number of people and gave them. if you can get the Calvinistic nonsense out of your mind and just look at what he says, this is a powerful passage. I've manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they are, and thou gavest them me. They have kept thy word. Now, who are those? Who's he talking about? That guy's sitting right here. He's talking about the 12 apostles. Verse number 9. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. Come down to verse 11. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, keep thou, by the way, any human that would use that term Holy Father, you know, it's just sort of a little arrogant prick. That's God the Father's name. Holy Father, keep thou thine own name, though through thine own name, I'm sorry, whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou hast given me, I have kept. None of them is lost but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Now, who was lost? Who's that? That's Judas. He was one of what? The 12. He's got this apostolic. They're going to sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes. He's got the hierarchy of his governmental structure in place. If you come down to verse number 24, very fascinating verse. Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. We planned this back before the foundation of the world, Father. Now it's being executed. So he prays for the 12 apostles. That's in verse 6 through 19. Then he prays for those who would believe, either have or in the future, verse 20 to 26. But before he prays for the 12 apostles and the little flock, he prays for himself. And that's what those first five verses are. And he makes two requests. Verse 1, Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Then verse 5, now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world began. Now, the reason there's two things there is one is he talks about thy Son. That's the position he acquired by coming to the earth. That's the thing in verse number 4. I've finished the work which thou hast given me. He does that. I have glorified thee on the earth. That's not the glorification that he had before the foundation of the world. This is the glory that he had in connection with his earthly ministry. You see, the Lord Jesus knows the dispensational setting that he's in. He knows he's dealing with Israel. He knows he's dealing with the reclaiming of the earth. Verse 12, he knows about the son of perdition. Verse 15, he prays, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. He knows there's a satanic policy of evil in the earth trying to destroy Israel, and it focuses on the little flock, especially the apostles in that case. And then, so he knows where he's at in this as he's praying. And when he prays, glorify thy son, that he may also glorify thee. The idea of sonship, and this is his sonship service, I would call it. He's fully conscious of his personal identity as the Son, the incarnate Son of God. He's perfectly conscious of the Father's will, and he's rejoicing in doing it. And that's what a son is in the Bible. Is someone who is not just a baby trying to figure out what God's doing, but he's come to the place where he understands God's will, but he doesn't just know it, he rejoices in doing it. That's what Son, that's who Christ, he knows every, we're going through the prayer. He knows all the things that are going on, and he knows the future and what needs to be done there. And he talks to the Father about it. When it says glorify him, that's talking about resurrection. He's going to glorify the Father. When you glorify God, you declare who he is. He says, I'm going to show people who you really are. So show them who I really am. He's declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead, Paul says. So he's talking about being resurrected. You go back to John 11 with Lazarus. John chapter 11, I think it's verse 40. Yeah. John 11, when Jesus heard that Lazarus was sick, verse 4. When Jesus heard that, he said, the sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified thereby. Well, how's that going to happen? Verse 40, Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldst see the glory of God? So what does she see? Verse 44, he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot. Lazarus come forth, and what did he do? He came out. The conquering of death. So he's praying about the resurrection. But why? Why does he ask that? Verse 2, that thy Son may glorify thee. The excellency of who Jesus was he never lived for himself, not for one moment. But he always lived for the glory of his Father. He always lived in the will of his Father. Then verse 5. Now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world began. Now we're back before he created anything. Now you're back in chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The same as in the beginning with God. Everything that was made by him. Colossians 1 says, made by him and for him. They had a plan. The Godhead did. And he says, after I've done this work, my essential identity is one with you. Verse 24 is always wonderful. The last of that verse says, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. By that verse, I've got written down Ephesians 1, verse 4. Because while all this is true of Israel and his prophetic program, Paul says that we've been chosen in him before the foundation of the world. You know what God's attitude toward his Son was before the foundation of the world? He loved him. When God chose you, you know what the motivation for choosing you was? His love for Christ. It's a wonderful thing. You need to appreciate who he is. You find out something. In a passage like this, you see into his heart. And in essence, what he said in verse 5 is, Father, I don't want to come home yet except through the cross. I don't want to get back where we were before until the work of redemption is accomplished. That was his dedication to the Father's will. So when the Father and the Son communicate, when they get down to the nitty-gritty of talking personally and they put it on the record, it's always that way. You see the Father's love for the Son, and you see the Son's commitment to doing the will of the Father that they, in eternity past, promised to accomplish. When you think of the excellency, you think of the wonder. Paul says, God commended his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Romans 8, verse 32, he spared not his own Son. Glorify thy Son. That's his own Son. And what did he do? He delivered him up for us all. How shall we not with him freely give us all things? I think those are the kind of things that the Apostle Paul came to see and understand in his Savior. They said, I'll count everything but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. He's the excellent one. And you know, if he could glory on the cross, in spite of being the one who had to go endure it, when you sing that song, In the Cross of Christ I Glory, towering above the wrecks of time, think about he's singing that song with you. And next week we'll go through, I'll spend some time going down through the thing in a little more detail, but I just want you to see the setup for that. The Father's always encouraging him. It's going to get done, and he's always trusting the Father. So when the Son and the Father talk, when the Son talks to the Father, when they pray over what God's doing. Not over the problems at hand, but what God's doing in the problems through him. And they commune over his word. And you'll see him make requests, you'll see him say things and so forth as you pray. We'll study the prayer. But it's always about, I want the Father's will accomplished. Okay? Anyway, for me, that's a thrill. All right, Father, we thank you tonight for the privilege that you give us just to be yours. To be able to commune with you over your word. To understand out of your word, to be taught by it about what you're doing. About what you think is important in our life because of what you're working. We thank you for the privilege that we can come with you even when our soul is sorrowful. And find peace and rest and joy in what you're doing and who you've made us. And how you've equipped us to endure through everything that's here, as our Savior did, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the Father on high. We thank you for that privilege and that high calling and the excellency that's ours in him. Amen. All right, praise the Lord.